Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Science Thursday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at trolleybuses. So let's dive right into it. Now, before we understand trolleybus itself, we have to understand the idea and the history behind public transport and why the heck we have need for cheap public transport. Now, this whole idea is very ancient. I'm talking 1800s, as in early industrial revolution period. Now, what happened during that time is like when economy started to boom, according to that time, not according to our standard, at that time when economy started to boom, like people were living next as close to as possible to their working place, as in factory, they had home. Now, as the production started to go up, they ended up with a scenario which we call shift transfer, basically 3 to 4 shifts. So the factory was running 24/7, but if workers were living so close to the factory, their health started to degrade because there was so much noise, so much pollutant and all that. So over time, it started to cause a lot of trouble. People started to dying from lung diseases, and basically it was just miserable living scenario. So somebody came up with this idea, let's quarantine the work area for the work area and living area completely independent. So okay, they did that. The problem is, this is before car became a thing, this is before you know, anything. So how do you transport this kind of people? Like, you know, I'm talking hundreds of people from point A to point B, and they can afford it. It is very crucial, they should be able to afford it. It cannot be like, you know, you built a metro system but it costs so much that people can't afford it. So during that time, railway is starting to catch up, and people realized very early on that if you have metal wheels on metal rail, the rolling resistance, as in how much energy you need to spend in order to get it rolling, it's very little. So in this came about after the understanding of during mining industry, is like people used to have wheel cart that they used to push around or pull. They can barely, you know, from mine to outside, they can barely get like upwards of 300 kilos. When somebody figured out, okay, let's put metal wheel on metal rail, that went upwards of 1 ton. So, and this is same power. The power did not went up, but your carrying capacity went up. So somebody came up with this idea, let's put rails on a road, okay, just bury it down. Now, horse-drawn carriages at that time was still a thing. Now, problem is, horse-drawn carriages are so expensive that only few people can afford it. And even those who can afford it, the cost was so damn high, because a two horse will barely able to pull 4 or 5 people or 8 people with any usable speed. So now they have metal tracks on the road. They built specific coaches for this, like this sort of tram. And trams were drawn by horses. Now they only needed 2 horses, reduced the cost, and horses were not exhausted, thus you know, leading them to die. So in this sort of scenario, this became very successful, and this started the whole tram system. Over time, somebody figured out, hey, electricity is here. We figured out how electric motors work, and DC electric motor had a lot of torque. So they are like, okay, let's use electric motors. Ta-da, normal tram. Now, as many of you know, if you have one wire that is coming from Tom, you cannot run a circuit because that's just live wire. So to ground it, to basically create a live and neutral, the neutral is generally the tram tracks itself acting as a neutral. That's why if you see a tram that has only one pantograph, that's a live wire, and the cold side, basically the cold wire, is the track itself. Now if you see something like that, metal on metal wheel, it does come with a consequence that it cannot go uphill, basically it cannot go up gradient, and when it's going down gradient, applying brakes on it is very difficult. So if you see something like this trolley car system that is going up the ground, generally they have something else happening. Like in this scenario, they have a third black patch that you can see, is generally there is a cable running underground. So the tram is only just gonna clutch to that cable, and cable is gonna pull them up. It's not running on its own power. Cable car, it's called. So this is the idea and the history behind it. So be mindful, this is very old technology. So when we are talking about trolley bus itself, the idea is very simple. Tracks are very expensive. So what if we remove the track? So, okay, buses started to come in, at the idea of buses at that time, and this time I'm talking about petrol buses, because diesel were not still catching up. Like we still needed a long way to go before we can use reliably diesel engines. So somebody's like, okay, we have power overhead system, we figured that out. Electric motors are more powerful than even the petrol engines of that time. Even today, like electric motors are more powerful, like if given volume, it's just that how the heck you're gonna deliver power to it. So we have the power delivery, we have the motor technology. Somebody said, like, let's make a trolley bus system. Now it is very simple, very cheap. As you can idea, this is the cheapest system I could find. This was given to Nepal, as in Kathmandu, as a gift from People's Republic of China. So this is very old, and this was done in 1900s. So it's very old technology, and it's tested to a point. Basically, the bus or trolley itself that was used in this sort of system lasted very long time. Now, at earlier days, people did not understand it. Why the heck it's lasting when normal buses only lasted from 5 to 10 years in heavy use? Why the heck these puppies were lasting even heavier use of upwards of 25 years? Over time, people figured out metal fatigue, and then they realized if you have engine mounted to a system, no matter what you do, the vibration energy is still going to the engine, like whole engine is, you know, shaking up the whole chassis, that causes fatigue. Over like day one, it's not an issue. After 1 year, okay, now minor fatigue has happened. After 5 years, okay, the whole chassis is starting to, you know, degrade apart. So we have created a lot of contingency to make sure that the issue is mitigated, but still it causes fatigue over time. So even if you buy a modern bus, it will not last very long. On these puppies, they give the surface life, like as in actual use in practice, in real life, upwards of 25 years of service life. So that's mind-boggling, and that is with old technology. If you build this sort of thing with current technology, with current engineering, you can make them last upwards of 50 years without any magical technology. So it's very old and tested. Now let's talk about environment. Now this is very environmental friendly. Now let's say you took all the diesel that you are using to drive your diesel bus and started burning that as a fuel source on your power plant, it still would be more efficient. Like how the heck, what about the transmission loss? Now be mindful, the buses are very light because they don't have to have that giant engine. So that's first, that flat out reduce the power consumption of these things. Second, if you have one exhaust port, like, you know, let's say one thing that is coming out, it is very easy to filter it out, no matter how big it is. If you have one source, all the diesel that you are burning is being burnt at one place, it's very easier to filter that out, clear that environment, so you can breathe easy. And I like the idea of breathing easy. So that's first advantage. Second, because all the generators that are used on the basically buses, trucks and things of that nature, be it railway diesel engine, they have a lot of constraints, so they are not very efficient. Now if you're talking about a power plant, everything is about efficiency. So you can't use those sort of engine on your car or your truck. So let's say your car gives you 10 miles per gallon. Can you build a car engine that can give you 20 miles per gallon? Yes, but it will cost 10 times more. So people won't buy it. On bus, they can afford upwards of 15 miles per gallon. But if you're talking about power plant, people will push so far ahead that they can afford 25 miles per gallon kind of energy efficiency. So the bigger you make, the easier it becomes to clean out the exhaust, and it becomes more efficient. So it's very environmental friendly. And if you are ever stuck in, next to a very big air-conditioned Volvo buses, you do know that when exhaust comes out, it's like that whole area behind the bus heats up. And I'm not talking like it does not go like 10 degrees Celsius up, but if it's in winter, people like to drive behind it because like that whole area is warmed up. And I don't like the idea simply because there is carbon monoxide also in that, and sulfur dioxide and nitrous oxide and other things that you don't like. So this is the reason why this sort of system is very, very environmental friendly. And this gives the one crucial advantage to every growing nation that they need, is that it eliminates the price fluctuation. So people can count on the system to give you a ticket price that they will not change upwards of, let's say, 5-6 years. Now, wherever you have small communities using bus service, the bus prices goes up as petrol prices go up. In this sort of scenario, it's not an issue, because generally, whenever you are talking about electric based system, the electricity is generally locally generated. Like you are burning your own coal, as in your own country's coal, you are burning your own country's gas. Generally, these sort of things are not impacted by basically world politics. And if you have wind power, solar power or geothermal, it's completely free. Generally, hydropower is used primarily for this sort of system. So you can understand that this can give you a city a very reliable transport service whose cost will not go up randomly, like tick 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 tick, cost will not go up. So this is very crucial for growing states. So let's talk, understand the power and transmission aspect of it. Now, as I already told you, if you have only one thing, like be it tram, be it metro, be it basically railway, you have one live, you have one neutral on the ground. Now, a bus does not have the luxury of having neutral on the ground. What do they do? They generally put two cables on top, something like this. Basically, you have dual cable system. As you can see, there is dual cable system. So one is live, one is neutral. Now, it is generally collected. The power is collected by flexible collectors. Now that flexibility allows the system to, you know, veer off course. So of course it does not mean like they can go 10 kilometers away. It's just that on a road network, like let's say it's a three lane road, they can bus can easily go to the last lane and this lane clear out and then come back. So generally the pole length, how far that pole extends from the bus, is generally determined on that. It's like how long, and of course there is engineering, you can't make it 10 meters long. So all things combined, it gives them flexibility enough that during road itself, the engineers will take into consideration how wide the road is. So you can easily move on the road without any constraints. And it is very flexible. It pivots from A to B. That's why they don't use pantograph. Now, pantograph is more efficient, like in some regards, it has less friction. But it has the consequence that if your bus moves even a little bit off track, as in off track here, like on road a little bit, yeah, your connection is gonna break. For this reason, you see two poles and very flexible poles that can pivot. And generally it's limited to 600 volt DC. Now you might be like, okay, why the heck voltage is so low, 600 volts? Like when train runs on like 25,000 volt or 1100 volts or whatever have you, why the heck this is limited to 600? One thing you have to understand, this is active area. Like as in people are walking here, as in trucks, cars, garbage truck, which is a giant metal object going below it. You have to make sure the electricity does not become emotional and jump. Now you might be like, okay, 600 volt is not gonna jump unless you are like, you know, 1 centimeter. What about during rain? For safety reasons, it's limited to 600 volts. And why DC? This is a very complex topic. I have already made a video about why we're gonna use high voltage DC in our future for power transmission. It's actually much more easier to transmit DC power than it is to AC. And all modern AC motor controller is basically converts AC that is receiving into DC. So people are like, okay, let's bypass that step. You know, basically your motor, if you have one single phase to three phase AC inverter, that is converting that AC coming in into DC. So directly give it DC, you know, save efficiency. And you can transmit DC much further along. So let's say you created a system where you have track length of 30 kilometers, you can transmit power from only one spot. In an AC system, you will need like every 2 to 5 kilometers, you will need voltage pull-ups transformers. So in those sort of scenario, you can understand the voltage is limited. You can't just boost the voltage up, even though you can build an inverter that's, let's say, absorbs 1200 volt DC. People wouldn't allow you to put 1200 volt DC lines here because, you know, cars is going below it, trucks are going below it, it can get short. For that reason, voltage limit DC for safety reason. Now motors in earlier days, I told you this is as old as 1860s, people were coming up with the idea. In 1890s, people started using this. So at that time, AC motors were not very efficient. Efficient when I'm talking about in terms of torque, they did not have torque. Even today, if you have simple, normal brushed DC motor, it generally has more torque than any AC motor, given the same power, as in same watt. So that's why people are olden days used to use DC motors. Now we use AC motors, AC three phase motors. And all of them, the modern ones specifically, have what we call short-term APU, basically auxiliary power unit. So they have batteries or sometimes diesel generator that will power it on if you know, power on top on these overlying wire goes down. This is done for multiple reasons. A, safety in case power goes out, they won't be stranded in the center of the road, they can, you know, park on site. And you know, this also makes the maintenance easier, so they can remove the pole and, you know, park the car wherever they want to. And these are the modern system where you have triangulated system, so it's very capable. Now before we understand the capability of any system, you have to look at its alternate. Now what about alternates here? Now alternative, every Tom, Dick and Harry who lives in a big city, they think they want metro. Everybody's like, we want metro, we want metro, with Delhi metro, Mumbai metro, Calcutta metro, whatever have you, Hyderabad metro, it's like New York metro, just everybody wants metro. Now you have to understand this, metros are blindingly expensive, as in upwards of $1 billion per kilometer is actually feasible in this sort of scenario. Now you might be like, okay, why the heck that are so expensive? Three reasons. First, they have to buy the land where they're gonna create what we call corridor. This is the reason why it's so expensive. Not only government have to buy the land below these things, they have to also build the corridor. Now the corridor could be above ground, like this sort of system where you have what we call elevated track, basically flyover, and it could be tunnels. Tunnels, anybody who knows familiar with tunnels, they are very expensive. This is very expensive. I'm not talking about trains yet, I'm just talking about the infrastructure you need for these trains. So yeah, they do provide a very efficient means of transport. They do provide cheap means of transmission, but it's very expensive. The capital investment, it's very big. And I'm talking so big that even a big government, be it China, be it America, they can't just like, okay, tada, do it. It's that expensive. That's why generally metro plans are done in phases or like stages, like, you know, stage one, stage two, because it's so damn expensive. And because it's so damn expensive, it also needs mega ridership, basically millions of people using it per day. If that's not happening, it's gonna, you know, go bankrupt. Now, even though many metro systems that are in use are bankrupt, government cannot close it because they spend so much money on it. It's just cheaper to run it. So in this sort of scenario, you have to understand, you can't just expect, let's say you have a town that is not a megapolis, like as in metropolis, but somewhere below, but does not have the throughput that is needed for metro. Nobody's gonna build metro there. And metros need one thing that is very difficult, especially for new cities, is that metro needs to be built before, like with future foresight, as in people's gonna live there, people gonna work here. Because if you do without it, like that happened in Bangalore and Hyderabad, Hyderabad specifically suffered because of this. In Bangalore, like they haven't connected the airport yet. In Bangalore, they haven't connected Salt Lake City, I think. So places that are not connected, people want to go there, metro is not useful for them. So you need to know beforehand, like you want to create the least amount of turns and bend and most amount of coverage. This is very difficult. So you might be like, okay, let's bypass this, let's build tram. Tram has the same rolling efficiency as I talked about, what you gain from metal wheel on metal track, but it comes with the consequence that trams are very expensive. Now, if you only talked about the railway side of it, like as in tracks and you know, coaches, trams are more expensive because the track built here is very high quality. Now the high quality is done because once it's buried underground, you can't maintain it easily, so the quality of material used is very high, unless somebody is cheaping out on that. Even if they are cheaping it out, what they will say, simply reduce the tram speed. So this can go upwards of 100 km/h. They will limit this to, let's say, 40 to 60, because they can't maintain the track to reduce the wear and tear on the track. Even though you could see clear road for let's say 5-6 kilometers, the tram driver cannot push the accelerator because there is no accelerator. Like it's limited to 40 kilometers per hour or whatever that speed, locally speed is. So this is very expensive, and it's on a road, it creates a lot of collision impact, basically cars that is getting bumped by, trucks that's getting done by. So whoever is designing the rolling stock, as in the coaches, they built it so that it can withstand some minor collisions regularly. Now that means that it ends up costing more. So if you are just talking about the train cost, this is more expensive. And because you are on road and you have created a basically permanent road path, you have to expect everybody who is using the road never to come on this. But as you can understand, it's just not feasible. So tram is very expensive. Compared to metro, it's cheap. But train itself is very expensive. But you also need very large ridership. Now, when I mean large ridership, to give you a context, what kind of numbers I'm talking about, is that in India, there is only one tram system remaining. That is in Calcutta. And that has a capacity to serve many lakhs of people. Right now, it's serving 2 lakh people, as in 200,000 people use it every day. And it's still in such a severe loss that people want to shut it down. And for good reason, it's just so much loss in that, because these things are so expensive and they can't maintain it. They can't upgrade the rolling stock, because if they built advanced train, it will go faster. It will damage the track, what already damaged track. Now, if you buy advanced system and run it slower, you are in debt already. So understand the tram is very expensive. Now we're like, okay, let's remove tram, let's remove metro for small cities. I'm talking like cities that are not super huge, but not super small also. So why not use electric bus? Again, it's super expensive right now, but it's also super heavy. Now that heavy part is not gonna change, because to give you a context, a normal car generally has 300 to 400 kilo for its propulsion. Now the weight of the battery bank used in Tesla Model 3 is generally Model 3, it's basically half ton. Now that's not that bad, but when you're talking about trucks or buses, it goes up to 2 to 5 to 8 tons, and the range is not that high. Range I'm talking about is barely 200 kilometers. That's not far enough. Now you might be like, okay, 200 kilometers more than enough for you and I, average people, and taxis. Yes, but buses are running continuously, and they are generally run on much longer tracks. Like you're not gonna have bus stop, like, you know, bus stop A and bus stop B. That's it. You're gonna have bus stop A to Z, and that Z part is like, let's say, 50 kilometers apart. So in those sort of scenario, that 100 kilometer range or 200 kilometer is sufficient for school bus and, like, you know, low traffic area. But for large mega cities, that's not enough. Now, China recently started to use electric bus. Now, they figured out, because of the giant battery, if you have very big battery that gives you very big range, you are wasting a lot of electricity, because even though nobody is on the bus, your bus is much heavier now. Now, electric motors are very lightweight. They are very lightweight, they are very dense and very compact. Everything is awesome about that. But the battery, you are wasting a lot of energy just moving the battery itself. How they compensate in China is simply shrink the battery bank to, let's say, they know every charging station, and this time what I'm talking about charging station is bus stop, is, let's say, 5 minutes away. So they build a battery bank that can withstand 15 minutes. So on top of every bus stop, they have a on top basically charging station. The moment bus comes in, it charges the battery. Now, sometimes it has physical connector, sometimes an induction charger, sometimes below road, sometimes on top of road. So that's the only way they can do it. So barring any super technology, I don't think battery buses are ready yet. Maybe in 100 years, maybe if somebody figures out something magical, because be mindful, lithium has this much energy level, let's say, and this is chemistry based. This is like physics, what will allow you. Now, when we are talking about real world physics, as in thermodynamics, it will never let you touch this. So let's say you got it here. Now here's the deal. This is our current lithium technology. So we're like, wait a minute, if lithium is that mature, why the heck we are doing so much research and experiment? Now, research and experiment is happening in different avenue. Yes, people want to make a lithium battery that lasts longer. Batteries have what we call cycle. So every time electricity changes direction, it causes one cycle. So you charge your battery, it's one cycle. Now you might be like, okay, I disconnected it, I'm gonna charge it again, it's still one cycle. No, because the moment you discharge, it started to going in drain mode, the battery started to lose power. Now, drain does not make a difference, like if it's happening 1 amp drain or very little drain, it's still a drain. So ideally you would want a bus system where you only need to charge it in the morning, basically overnight you charge it full and that's it. So that way every day is one cycle for the battery system. Now that also gets complicated if you have regenerative braking, because it's changing the electrical direction. So you can understand that, and lithium only goes upwards of 3000. 3000 is practical, like you can buy right now your drill batteries that have that kind of range. But 3000 is not that much, because every time you are applying brake, you are changing electricity. So you can understand it. And so all the engineering research is going on, making sure the battery charges quickly, battery is more safer, battery is more cheaper. None of them are focused on like, okay, I'm gonna have this 10 liter battery that's gonna weight less. And that's gonna be like weightless, as in, let's say it used to weight 50 kilos, it's gonna weight 25 kilo, and it's gonna have 10 times the power. That's just not possible with lithium. Lithium has maxed out. So this is why, please understand this. Metro, very awesome, but only for select states. Tram, very expensive and does not offer that much reliability. Electric bus are not ready for the prime time yet. So what we can expect in the future? Now, this whole trolleybus system that I'm very informed of with this idea, because this came way too early. It was like widespread so much that 600 cities have this. Now you're like, okay, 600 cities had this, then what the heck happened? This came way too early. This is one of those scenarios where you're like, you know, the world wasn't ready. It came from 1800s to 1900s. What we didn't have that? Cheap petrol, cheap diesel, cheap cars, and cheap buses. When those things came in and economy started to boom, everybody started the idea, oh, I'm gonna buy my own car. That was the dream. Now here's the problem with that dream. If you are talking about 1 to 3 million people living in one city, in one place, you don't have enough road to, you know, power 20-30 million basically cars and truck buses. For that reason, you need public transport. Now, public transport, now everybody thinks of metro, because these are forgotten. Even though they are very efficient, very practical in more way than not, and I'm providing a lot of videos down below from how tram tracks are constructed, how a lot of trolley systems are there that is already in use, not like, you know, some mathematical thing, in use practically. You can go in Europe and buy tickets for that, and a lot of Russian cities still maintain there, and it's profitable for them. So, and the fact that it was so cheap that people did not think too much before they dismantled it. After they dismantled it and oil price went up, then like, ah, shit. So be mindful, there's a very quick and easy solution right now. Like right now, this is there, we got it. And this is a very stopgap solution unless we have next generation of battery. And I'm talking at least four times powerful and four times light also. Not a battery that weighs 10 ton. So until that magic battery happens, this is a very good solution. Now, one thing also I found out during my research is there is some technology known as guided bus. Basically, you'll have a small wheel on top of your steering wheel. This is a manual, I'm saying. This is a basically on-off feature. You can turn it on or off. So once you turn it on, it attaches on the side of the track and uses the track. So you have guided bus. Now this will make sense. Let's say you are living in Bangalore and you want to go to airport. You don't want to go through normal basically traffic route simply because A, traffic, B, if long buses are going there, it also slowing down the traffic around it. So how would you trust a system that is inflicted in traffic? You create guided bus. Now this track may look fancy, it's just simple concrete, nothing fancy. It's like not even as expensive as road, it's very cheap. So from city centers to, let's say, of course, it won't have this track in the city. Now, once it comes out, then tracks will go into this. And once you are here, you will have clear line of sight till airport or till, let's say there's nearby small town that is like, lot of people going daily up and down. And railway is not going to make cost effective sense. And tram and metro, not going to make sense. This makes sense. And you can start the basically guideway path right away, and as more people start using it, you can do overhead wiring, so you can have electric buses. So these sort of system makes a lot of sense if you have large city that has things that are far apart, and as I'm talking about like airport, or let's say there is a attraction as in Disney World, or basically a large amusement park that a lot of people go to but is very far, you can have this sort of structure. Like, of course, it does need enough people, using it regularly to pay for this sort of system, but it's very cheap, relatively speaking, and it gives you reliable travel. It's not like, if bus is there, what happens if I get stuck in traffic? No traffic. These are dedicated corridors, and there are some fancy engineering done on this. So if you try to go send your car into that, you will get stuck. So there are a lot of interesting solutions. So this was my video on trolley buses. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it. You can dislike it. And I would urge you to leave a comment what you want to see in the next episode of Future Friday. And please share it amongst your friends. Please subscribe. And if you're free, press the bell icon. And as always, thanks for watching.